Many of us spend part of each day walking past walls, but people quite often don't look at the ecology and think about how the ecology works. And that's what I'd like to do today. I've come to a fairly atypical wall. This is Bury St Edmund's Abbey in Suffolk in England. This was built in the 12th century and destroyed by Henry VIII in 1539. But the principles apply more generally, although this is ecologically richer than most walls. So how do plants take advantage of these structures? The simplest approach is shown by this ivy here. This is growing in the ground here, and then left to itself, it will then take advantage of this structure and then just grow up this wall, just using it for support. But I'm pretty sure that the authorities won't allow that to happen. So these walls are pretty difficult conditions, unless you're like the ivy and growing in the ground. There's very little soil, the temperatures are very variable, it's very hot during the heat of the day, cold at night, when it's pouring with rain, these will be very wet, and then these will then dry out and become pretty arid. So they're kind of quite difficult conditions to grow in. But there's a group of species that specialize in these conditions. These are called lithophytes, and we've got some of those here. This is called pellitory of the wall. That's a pretty stupid name for it. Pellitory means of the wall. So this is of the wall. It's called spreading pellitory in many other countries, a much better name. Or here, this is ivy-leaved toadflax. Another wall specialist is a third one here. There's various others, which I won't show you here. This is red valerian. This has deep, long tap roots. So I'm sure it's growing well inside that wall, finding the water and the nutrients deep down inside that wall. So there's considerable variation within these walls in terms of the direction it's facing and the structure. So here, this is a fairly newly improved and mended bit of wall. This is south facing. There's not really any soil here. This will be very hot during the heat of the day, cold at night, very dry, pretty difficult conditions. But here, there's a damper, slightly damper area, the mortar hasn't been improved, and this has got mosses. This is a silky wall feather moss here. It's got ferns, his heart's tongue fern here. So damp walls very often are good for mosses and ferns. So this is very variable. So if you were to go to southwestern England, where it's damper, you would have a greater diversity of species than Devon and Cornwall. The walls are just sort of dripping with life because the conditions are less difficult there. So walls are a mix of rocks or stones with mortar in between, and mortar is burnt limestone mixed with sand and water to create this paste that then sticks all of this together. And the geology of the wall makes a real difference to the sort of species that occur here. So this here is, this is Barnack stone, that's oolitic limestone, and flints are silica, hard, don't erode much. And studies have shown that the stones age, and left in these walls, they become more absorbent, and so they absorb water. The stone, the wall will absorb water and then gradually release it, and they'll erode away so that they'll provide soil under which plants can then grow. And experimental studies have added plants to walls that differ in the type of stone, the type of mortar, and show this considerable difference in the ability of plants to grow depending on exactly what types of stone there are and what sort of mortar there is. So how then do plants get to these sites? So you kind of imagined with gravity that seeds would just drop down and couldn't be colonized. And there's a couple of strategies. So for red valerian, the seeds there, I don't know if you can see that, they have a sort of parachute-like feathery seed, which then will get carried by the wind, and the wind will come and blow against this wall and blow up, there'll be up currents, and carry those seeds and take them up in the air and then be dispersed and perhaps on top of another wall. Other strategies, this is going back to the ivy-leaved toadflax. And you can see here the flower, and the flower grows towards the light. So the flower stem sticks out as much as it can so it can get pollinated. But once it has been pollinated and it turns into a seed capsule, then its growth changes. So it now grows into the wall, looking for dark areas, crevices, in order to deposit its seeds. And further, all the seeds are then carried by ants. So ants will arrive, take the seeds, and they've got lysosomes, food-rich areas to make them attractive, and then take them, quite possibly, way up in the wall and deposit them up there so they can then be dispersed. So what I'm saying is that walls have an interesting set of species. They're very variable, and because they're very variable, there's a great diversity of habitats that attracts different sorts of species. And a large number of species have been recorded. 850 species have been recorded, of plants have been recorded on walls in Britain. 360 occur regularly. And you kind of never know what you're going to see. So here, as well, the surprise to see this deadly nightshade plant growing here, not a very common plant in Britain. So you never really know what you're going to see when you're looking at a wall. So walls are interesting ecologically. A lot depends on the history and the geology and the variation in aspect, but it's always worth having a look as you're walking along and see what you see. Enjoy.